Greetings, ladies and managers, and welcome to this latest edition of Tales from Hannah's Maze, where I take stories from across the internet and read them for your entertainment. This particular story is called For the Fallen, written by Farm Witch 4275. Captain, unidentified warp signature, Sector 7-1. The communications officer yelled out, breaking the calm of the station. All crews to stations, all hands on deck, Captain Terran yelled out, standing proud on the deck. Within minutes, every man and woman on board was at full alert, out of their quarters and away from their comfort of the Cassarin crystal displays and at the cold steel and polymer that was their assigned stations. Warp signature is growing. Detected capital class ship. Approximate size at 1,100 meters.
1,100! That's a dreadnought! Shields to maximum power!
Terran commanded. He was now definitely concerned. Border disputes were common, especially with the Serentists nearby, so this very well may be a raid.
Serentist bastards might be hitting us with a surprise attack. Call for reinforcements.
Warp signatures are getting stronger. Bubble collapsed in 3, 2, 1. Target sighted.
The beast that appeared from that wormhole was not a Serentist warship. It was nothing like they'd ever seen before. A massive beast the size of a small city, over a kilometer long, bristling with massive cannons. The armor plating was a dark gray in color, mixed with red and gold trimming. At its front sat a massive, terrifying effigy of some kind of creature's skull. The broadsides were covered in a strange emblem or marking. The emblem was a flag of black, gold, and red, with a seven-pointed star at the center of a large gear wheel. A black background, the gear wheel being of a stitched gold and the stars being a very menacing scarlet red. We could very clearly make out that every inch of the ship's hull was covered in thousands of letters and symbols, clearly denoting a language. The closer it got, the less it scared us, and the more it awed us. Every single part, piece, and component of the ship was handcrafted to a legendary quality. Thousands of small statues covered its surface, every armor plate covered in either a sort of holy seal or written text etched into the armor in gold or red. It approached the station where I stood on the bridge alongside the captain. It was at this point our communications failed. The radio chatter cut into dead silence, replaced by one of the most hauntingly beautiful voices that I or anyone else had ever heard. It was a language none of us could even begin to comprehend, but the voice that spoke it sent us into a delirium. Every radio, every screen, every communications array across the entire system now played the song. The sounds of multiple voices began to join the cacophony. A dozen voices singing in perfect unison with two speaking words, the others simply humming or maintaining a chord to carry the song. It was a song that filled all who heard it with an intense feeling of sadness, loss, and mourning. One that few of us had ever felt before. The ship slipped effortlessly through the maw of space, closing the gap, and finally coming to rest near the station. Its underbelly opened, and out came another ship, a very badly damaged ship. The massive, ornate beast moved away from the station, then pulled a turn that would have as easily sheared any ship that we had clean in half. It sat there in silent vigil as if waiting for the music to end. That haunting, beautiful sound continued for 7 minutes. On the plant's surface, thousands of men, women, children, even the normally stoic Admiralty, were in tears. Soldiers in formation prepared for an invasion were standing at attention in their posts, involuntarily giving a salute. Then the song changed. An increase in tempo and change in tone had suddenly all who heard it filled with a sense of pride and accomplishment. Officers wiped tears of sadness from their faces and replaced them with a sense of pride and tears of joy. Crying younglings in the streets now had smiles on their face. An overwhelming sense of pride and accomplishment smashed into the populace like a tide of water and ice. The warships we asked for arrived, but did nothing. Coming close to the ship, scanning it, or just looking at it, awestruck, as if a god had suddenly struck a chord in our souls and commanded us to shut up and listen. The song finally ended, Just as abruptly as it had arrived, the ship sped off, then vanished into the darkness through a warp portal. All communications returned to full functionality. I moved closer to the viewing screen, wiping the tears from my face as I tried to regain my composure. It was then I noticed what it had left behind. "By all the gods, is that a Palaiko?" I exclaimed, finally noticing the badly damaged ship near the station.
"But what?"
Captain Terran and several others got up from their stations and rushed to the viewing port. Indeed, it was a Palaiko, one of our exploration ships, carrying the best and brightest of our species, lost to the empty void of space decades prior. Our first real exploration ship, a shattered hulk of scrap and twisted metal, covered in seals and mysterious emblems. The ship itself seemed unable to function, such was the damage. So it appeared to have been secured by some kind of metal beam casing that probably stopped it disintegrating. We went into a frantic panic and swarmed the derelict. I rushed in just behind the boarding team wearing pressure suits. We entered the ship's main cargo bay. The sight that greeted us broke us, sent us into despair. Coffins. 247 coffins, perfectly laid out in the cargo bay, bathed in a soft blue light from a series of ornate light posts that created artificial flame-like candles. Each coffin had a viewing port in it, in which you could perfectly see the face of its occupant. Some members looked around and tried to open the devices, believing its occupants were still alive. I looked around, and my eye caught the glint of silver in one of the boxes. I rushed towards it. The glint of silver belonged to an all-too-familiar necklace. I collapsed on the floor, reaching out for the last hug as I saw the face of my lost granddaughter. I began to sob uncontrollably, and others rushed towards me to see if I was okay. I was not. Needless to say, it was a matter of severe shock as to what we encountered. It took us a few months to sort through and collate the data we acquired, mostly because we were too busy burying the dead. The coffins were made of a polycarbonate substance similar in structure to an artificial wood substrate. Various toxic and otherwise inert fluids were used to the bodies to prevent orderly slow decomposition. The bodies were preserved and positioned in such a manner that it seemed as though the occupants were asleep instead of dead. We confirmed that it was somewhat jarring to find them in this state, but also calming. Once proper funeral services were conducted, questions began to fly. It was an insult to the dead to try and get a sample of the fluid used for preservation, so scientists began to attempt to create their own using the minimal data that we did have. Some families attempted to volunteer their relatives to the cause. We rejected every attempt and swore an oath to never let this act be wasted. We laid our greatest heroes to rest a month after the first encounter and got back to work. What was that ship? Scans collected from every ship that could scan it or any crew that could operate despite the circumstances showed us a few things. It was made of an extremely advanced alloy that we couldn't dare replicate, showing highly advanced design that could completely ignore laser fire. Shield strength readings were 10 times what our flagships could output. It was producing energy readings that were absurd by any standard. A few of the gas giants in our home systems couldn't produce that much energy. Weapon systems, from what little we could gather, would outclass every ship in the fleet 100 times over. Kinetic bombardment cannons, ballistic munitions cannons, beamweb, point defense laser arrays, and we could, from photographs, determine the outline of launch bays for thousands of missiles and rockets. What was that language? The deck on the outside was beyond absurd. So, how did they gain access to our entire communication network? No trace of any signal was ever found. No means of entry was ever located. We have no idea how they seized our entire communication system, then used it to sing. What language was it? It wasn't much to work with, but our translation algorithm and software assigned the language as Latin and began to translate the song. In the meantime, we started combing through the flight logs of the exploration ship. A simple accident involving a meteorite collision on exiting warp too close to an asteroid field. 24 crew members were left to die of starvation or exposure, while the rest died on impact or within a few minutes due to suffocation. I broke down in tears several times during the investigation on seeing recordings of my granddaughter with her crew. Finally, after a fair amount of time and several unfortunate breakdowns, the algorithm finished the translation. It is better to celebrate a life well lived and the impact it had on those around it than it is to mourn a life that has been lost. So long as you are remembered, so long as your footsteps are still where your path has led you, death is meaningless. Only those forgotten are truly dead. So long as you are remembered, so long as you are loved, you are immortal. So long as your impact is maintained, so long as the shadow of the tree that you planted still remains, you are immortal. So long as you are loved, you had a greater impact on the universe than the death of a thousand suns. In the memory of the fallen, to those who came before and give all they had to those who are now, we salute you. In memory of the fallen, to those who bled in the wars long past, we salute you. Together in the future, we shall not let your sacrifice, however small it be, wasted. Together to the void, we shall carry on in your footsteps and let your thunderous voices be heard. Together to eternity, raise a glass to those before you and share bread with those who are now. Together to victory, together to the void, against eternity, we shall not falter. Rest in peace, for your work is done. Rest in peace, for it is our turn now. Rest in peace, for your greatness now shines through us. We are those you fought for, those you died for, those you lived for. We are the future, and we shall not falter. Together to the future, together to the void, together for eternity. Together we are immortal. These simple words broke the Empire, literally broke us. In front of a delegation of our best warriors, one of our generals collapsed into tears. Our emperor confined himself to a temple for a week, refusing any food as penance. Holy sites such as temples and graveyards suddenly became flooded with tens of thousands of people. Apologies and confessions of sins and crimes flooded the network, with former crime bosses and criminal gangs walking into police stations and locking themselves in prisons. Our entire society changed, all because of this one ship. This gesture, an act of kindness for the family of these lost, and a mark of respect for the dead. Who? Why? As much as recent revelations changed us, we were still at war with an enemy two star systems away. We quickly got back into focus. Some weeks after this, however, that all came to an abrupt conclusion. I was up in the defense station, overseeing trade deals with some old allies, when a mass alert rang out. It was a Serian shield fleet. Hundreds of warships suddenly appeared at our borders. Then hundreds more. Then more than that. Then far too many. Even if we called our entire reserve, not only would they not get here in time, there was no way in oblivion that we would survive. We wouldn't go down without a fight. Damn them to oblivion. We would take as many of them with us as we could. That's what we thought, at least. Until that bastard flagship of theirs warped in behind them. The planet killer. The one that destroyed Kasim Prime at the start of the war. Thankfully, it wasn't too heavily populated, but it was no less of a loss. The fleet assembled before us was too much. Whatever fight we had, it would wipe us out. They hailed us, and the Emperor himself, Jahed Valhem, was on board the flagship.
I demand your presence on board my flagship. Bring your emperor to me now.
To discuss terms of surrender, I'm guessing, I said flippantly, trying to stall for time. The laser beam shot out of the flagship's support bleat.
That was a warning shot. I shall not ask again, he commanded.
I relayed the message to my own Emperor, Aphahid VII. Within the hour, he and I were on board a shuttle on the way to the emissary barge. The Emperor Jahad was sitting on his grandiose throne in front of us, an expression of rage on his face as we approached. Jahad the red-skinned and Aphahid the blue-skinned. We are a species of roughly similar features, with those of blue skin seeing slightly shorter and stronger, while our red-skinned foes have greater intellect but larger stature.
Jahad,
Aphahid, we meet again. The two men regarded each other as we stood in their halls, the meeting broadcast for all to witness. A moment of tense and absolute silence. So much so, the sneeze of a rodent could be heard 12 systems away. Emperor Jahad's expression changed as he broke the silence, dropping to his knees, prostrating himself before my Emperor, and beginning to cry copious tears.
Please, forgive us, he cried,
as his tears stained the ground. Aphahid now stood silent, his jaw agape at the sight of a generations-old enemy suddenly dropping to the floor in tears. A warrior king reduced to a blubbering mess in front of the Empire's subjects. Aphahid and I looked at each other in confusion for a moment, before Jahad finally stopped his blubbering long enough to eke out a coherent statement.
How many brothers, how many lives have been wasted in this conflict? How many of our sons and daughters have we sent to the deaths? It was all for nothing. Nothing. It was all a lie,
he yelled in between sobs. Jahad pressed a button on a holographic screen appeared, laying bare evidence that nearly made me pass out. The first image laying out the displayed and carefully preserved remains. Among them, pictures of crew members, carefully preserved in the same pristine coffins. The crew members all had a mixture of blue and red skin, and among them, a young mother holding a child with purple skin.
Liars and traitors, murderers and criminals, all of them. When we thought the ship's lost, we were told that it was your doing. They fabricated everything and sent us into a mad, pointless war against our own kind. They have been smote from the universe with as much malice as I could muster. I come here to pay for my recklessness and sanity. My own daughter was amongst those ships.
Jahad had sat on his knees with his head bowed and presented his arms up as if he was ready for a rest.
Forgive me.
Afayat stood stunned for a moment, then reached down and grabbed one of Jahad's hands, pulling him to his feet and embracing him, both men in tears.
You are forgiven, brother.
Some months passed and our mutual war had been all but forgotten. Reparations from both sides were forgotten simply out of the need to bring peace. A new chapter in our history began. But through all this, one question remained. Why? Jahad's own fleets were met with the same kind of ship we encountered on that fateful day. The same markings, scripts, and even the same haunting music. Only one they counted was much, much larger. It was on an anniversary of our first year as an alliance. And we got an answer. A communications tech from one of our security cruisers barged into the grand hall, causing a commotion, and evaded the guards to approach Emperor Jahad and Aphahid. She was extremely agitated, but he had a curious smile on his face.
What is the meaning of this?
Jahad yelled, his temperance unchanged from his previous rule.
I found it. I got a signal back,
she yelled excitedly.
Found what? The Temperance launched a gathering of signal probes towards the ship that retrieved the polyecho. One of them managed to attach itself somehow to the armor plating, and we got a signal back 20 minutes ago, she squealed excitedly.
She quickly gathered her portable equipment and brought up a galaxy map, highlighting a particular point in a far-flung segment of the galaxy. A marker designated the system as Sol. The signal was a bit garbled, but eventually the technician, still keeping us on the edge of our seats, in my case, literally, as she tried to recover something.
Ah, I got it. The probe took a few pictures, she said excitedly.
A button was pressed, and the image that greeted us shattered our fragile hearts. There were thousands of those ships, each one in varying state of destruction, disuse, or decay. Each one bearing a plaque on which were written hundreds of names. On each ship, a metal plate was welded wherever it could. Each plate had the phrase, "Death is not which must be feared. It is a companion that we must take in our stride. Gone, but never forgotten. Lest more be lost, never forget." It was a graveyard. A massive, massive star system-sized graveyard. Our hearts sank as the probe performed a bioscan and found only silence. A closer look at the nearest ship revealed it to be almost entirely automated, despite the damage it sustained. Our military commanders were now seriously worried and wondered what could have caused any damage at all to these ships, as they murmured amongst themselves. We cycled through some of the picture the probe took as more of them arrived through the data stream. Photos of larger swaths of the system showed countless derelict starships anchored in place around the entire star system by artificial gravity hooks. Derelicts of innumerable manufacture and quantity, not made by the locals, but by countless other races. Thousands upon thousands of ships, ranging in size from fighters to multi-mile-long titans. Megastructures of any conceivable kind surrounded every planetary body. Refineries, military installations, matryoshka brains, massive megastructures, and what looked to be a stellar ignition unit, lying shattered and broken amongst one of the gas giants. This entire star system appears to be a massive graveyard. But it looked far from dead. However, one thing that puzzled us was, where is everybody? All we could make out were automated drones and machines. No people. At least none that were alive. We cycled through more astonishing pictures until finally I pointed and yelled, "There! Right there! See it!" Everyone looked carefully at my fingertip and spotted the clear sight of a bipedal creature in a thick mech suit, welding a memorial plate to ship's hull. "By the ancients, I do," Jihad said. "What is it? Two arms, a head, two legs? Even in that mech suit, I can tell that much. Do you have anything that shows it up close?" Afi had asked the technician.
"No, my lord, that's the last photo I have. We are still getting more. The next one will get here in about 2 minutes. Then it's another 8 for the data to correlate and process. We are working as fast as we can," she replied, trying to keep calm.
"In the meantime, Captain Terran, ready our ship and plot a course to that system."
"I have an idea," I said out loud and excused myself from the table.
"Wait, the last photo is ready. I have it here, now."
The final photograph loaded. We were startled out of our seats as the strange creature was now in front of the optical lens, staring straight into it. Its mouth was curved upwards in what was clearly a smile. Its eyes were a haunting, beautiful brown, but even in the cursory glance, one could feel a heavy, saddened burden emanating from its expression.
"That is what's there. Why?"
Jihad spoke.
"Why does it look like us, Oni? Without the pointy ears and the pink skin,"
Afayad replied, finishing the statement.
"Captain, ready our ship."
The journey took us 6 months. Sol was 147 jumps from home, but we were set for the long haul as Jihad gave us one of his heavy battleships, retrofitting it for an extended journey instead of me struggling with my old diplomatic frigate. I had with me on the bridge General Hakim and Admiral Gohan, along with Captains Terran and Soren. Alongside me was my fellow diplomat, Master Ragan. We were moments away from entering the system around the planetoid designated Pluto, and the atmosphere was palpable.
"I don't like this. I don't like this one bit," General Hakim spoke above the din as he stood at the viewing port.
"Neither do I."
"What the hell are you doing with that?" Admiral Gohan asked and gestured to the bouquet of flowers I was holding.
"Don't worry, I have a plan. Just let me do all the talking. The probe secured some data files and other things from the Polyoko. I know what I'm doing."
I smiled at him, though I will admit, I did nothing to calm the atmosphere.
Exiting hyperlane in 3, 2, 1.
Entry, the ship's pilot yelled, grabbing everyone's attention. The ship popped into existence just beyond the system's perimeter. Within moments of our appearance, we had 10 dreadnoughts appear and aim their cannons at us. The voice of the machine hijacked our communications, and a holographic image of the machine-like eyeball appeared in front of us on the bridge. It tracked us. Very advanced tech, if they could project their holograms through our shields and into our hulls.
You have entered a secured star system. Designate objective immediately. You have 5 minutes to comply.
The machine spoke, and it was clearly agitated. I spoke in response. We are here to pay our respects to the dead. One of our ships is recorded to be here. We wish to speak to the one in charge of here to recover that ship and bring it home. I made sure to hold the flowers up so they could clearly see.
Processing request.
A few tense moments passed.
Confirmed. Ship manifest and cargo match intentions. Gravekeeper has been notified. Please proceed alongside designated area. Maintain low speed to avoid incident.
A series of bright holographic arrows appeared and our pilot took the initiative, moving us through the pathway. We looked around and took in the sights. Some of these ships were massive. We ran a basic scan while we could. One such ship was over 20 miles long and nearly 4 miles in height and width. Most of the megastructures and giant stations were intact and appeared fully functional, though a bioscan done still produced no life signs, only machines. Millions upon millions of machines. A few minutes later, the Admiral pointed towards our destination.
Retribution Kiss, a ship Jihad lost a few decades ago. A ship full of heroes. I knew it. I knew I saw that ship on the feed,
I exclaimed as we got closer. Our comms suddenly cut and were replaced with music. Beautiful, somber, sad music. We docked with the ship with a thud. The Retribution Kiss had its entire aft section destroyed. Several holes punctured through most of the rear superstructures, and a starboard thruster pod looked like it had been on fire. A somber mood overcame us all as I headed to the end. On entering, I was immediately greeted by the sight of more of those precious coffins, each one ornately decorated with its occupant appearing sound asleep. I approached fully aware I was no longer alone as the crew followed and placed the flowers I was carrying on one of the coffins. Everyone else followed suit. Soon, the entire crew, save a few needed volunteers, had come out with their own bunch of flowers. We each stood with our heads bowed as we silently uttered a prayer for our fallen brethren. It was only now we noticed the figure standing in the room, its hands in front of it and its head low. We continued for a minute or so, placing more flowers and allowing scholars to take notes of names for the dead. I motioned to the being at the opposite end of the room if we could pick them up and take them home. It simply nodded in agreement, and I called for us to quietly carry the coffins on board the battleship. I stood by and waited as each body was carried away. The music finally ended. I looked to my left, noticing the creature standing next to me. It was a clear 2 feet shorter than I was. I could now clearly see more of its features, obscured as they were by the robe he wore. Definitely a male. 5 fingers instead of our 4, a small tuft of hair atop its head, with more on its face, grown long and grey, instead of completely bald like us. Rounded short ears instead of jagged edged like us.
A simple lesson to learn. But one that has no lesser impact. Never forget, lest we lose more. Never forget, lest they be gone forever.
I waited for a moment to respond, allowing my translation unit to work.
You are the Gravekeeper. The machines told us about.
Aye, that I be. The name is Grim, or at least I think it is. It's been a while since I needed to care. About 1,400 years, to be exact,
he said, looking up at me.
Can you explain that?
I asked, trying my best to be polite.
Look, son, I know why you are here as much as I do, so let's not sugarcoat it. I've done this far too long now, so I'll cut to the chase. You are here only because you saw one of your own ship. But, let's face it, you came here to do more than just recover bodies. He looked up at me with a certain degree of side-eye.
Well, I sighed in defeat.
Highly advanced tech, massive warships, uncountable technologies. You can say you had an ulterior motive for being here. But at least I can appreciate the sincerity of the funeral service. At least you respect the dead. Now tell me, why are you really here?
To thank you for bringing my granddaughter back home. To thank you for bringing that ship back. To thank you for giving me a chance to say goodbye. I smiled down at him, a tear forming in my eye.
You are welcome. It is my job. And what's the other thing?
To ask some questions. To see if we can negotiate a proper trade. To see if we could be friends. I said, holding my hand out. He looked at me and sighed.
Aye, friends it is.
He shook my hand.
So, lad, I'll spare you the trouble of asking and I'll just answer. My species abandoned the galaxy some 1400 years ago because we were beset by enemies on all sides. Constant war, but no friends. This place became more of a memorial than a home system because of how many losses we were taking. Eventually, we were left with few choices and simply just buggered off. I was one of the very few volunteers to stay behind when everyone left. We found no friends here and simply just decided it wasn't worth sticking around. So we packed up and left. He explained as he led me to the edge of the room, overlooking the view of Earth.
That is very disappointing. I cannot imagine what it would be like to abandon one's home.
I'm not completely alone, of course. Every now and then, I get pilgrims coming from other galaxy, and they visit Earth. We built all this, you know. Probably have a lot more. Come to think of it, how long before you go home?
He looked up at me with a peculiar smirk.
Well, we have to refuel the ship and hold some vigils, but we should be returning home in a few days. Why?
If you stick around for a week or so, you'll be able to catch a pilgrimage. I'm not the only human in the universe, but I am the only human here. If you are willing to be patient, you'll be able to conduct a proper first contact with the Federation, he said,
his smile and expression now seeming to calm down.
Actually, I would love that. I will go tell the commanders. I'll arrange it all. Thank you again.
No problem. Anything for a friend.
End of story. There is a new legend on the horizon. Blueberry Cat has taken the T6 Patreon spot. Thank you very much, and I am sure that I speak for everyone when I say that. I would just like to thank our T5 members, Lord Azrakil, Ambrose Cattell, Quantum Wednesday, Dregzoon WRE, Blueberry Cat, Cam Maxwell, Casper Arnholtz, Bushmaster 177, and Leslie 517. Thank you very much.